Welcome to Healing, Hope, and Restoration, Issues and Answers in Christian Mental Health. Now here's your host, Pastor and Christian Counselor Howard Love, with today's topic.
Welcome, Central Illinois, to Healing, Hope, and Restoration. This is your host, Howard Love. Today we have a special guest in the studio with us. This young lady has been a friend of our family for approximately 10 years, and I have certainly admired her in terms of her courage and her faith and the way in which she carries her Christian walk. And it's just a privilege to have Elizabeth Grant with us today. Elizabeth, welcome.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Elizabeth is here because, as I said, she's really been an example of courage. Elizabeth is now fighting her second round of cancer. She is a 38-year-old wife and mother of two children. And we attended church with her some time back, and that's how her and my wife got to know each other. As we've watched Elizabeth walk through these two battles with cancer, I was moved to bring her in the studio and interview her and just kind of talk about how facing this dreaded disease has affected her, some of her ups and her downs, and just kind of share with our listening audience, Elizabeth, where the Lord's brought you through this process.
Thank you. Well, first of all, I must say I am very, very honored to be here. I do not feel qualified. I know some of your previous guests have written books and have degrees and things, and I'm just a normal person. I was diagnosed with breast cancer when I was 28 years old. Needless to say, it was quite a shock to my family. We have no history whatsoever, so I heard the word cancer, and a hundred things went through my head. I had no idea, no frame of reference to think about. Not only that, I had my children were 2 years old and 4 months old at the time. So I was a new parent, and I was breastfeeding and trying to potty train my daughter. And all of that kind of just had to stop whenever I got the diagnosis. And that's about, I don't know what else you want to know at the time.
Well, did you ever, in any of those moments of questioning and wondering, say, this is not fair, this isn't right?
No, not really. And actually, it's very odd, and I don't know if it's just the way God designed me or my personality or whatever, but I tend to think pretty practically about things. I sort of, throughout the initial treatments and the mastectomy and the chemo, I sort of realized that this was just a season in my life, kind of a hiccup, if you will, in the grand scheme of every year that I'm going to be around. So honestly, I think I might have shed a few tears. I actually brought with me a journal entry I wrote the very day I found out, and I'd like to read it because it's very, very short. I think I think I cried right as I was writing it, and then at the end of my writing, I think I took a nap and I didn't cry or shed a tear since. So I just wrote, I just had a mammogram 2 days ago, and it was decided that I needed to get a biopsy. I just had the biopsy an hour ago, and we'll get the results tomorrow. But today, the doctor wanted to prepare me that she thinks it's cancer. Whoa, the big C. What does this mean? Am I going to suffer? Will I die soon? Oh, Lord, I'm so emotional. I don't feel I'm ready to leave this earth yet. I'm just beginning to discover your plan for me and my purpose on earth. Of course, I want to be with you for eternity in heaven, but what about my children? Oh, I know that they are your children. You will take care of them. And I do know that heaven is my home, not earth. Then why am I so torn? All right, I humbly come to you broken. Take my life, Lord, no matter how many days that might be. Show me how to live for you and how to die for you if need be. I love you, Lord. You are constant. And that was pretty much it. I wrote that, and it transformed the way I thought. Instead of thinking about my own problems, I diverted my attention and my focus on what's really important, which is Jesus and heaven and eternity, recognizing that God is sovereign and he has a plan for this. And that's just kind of how I approach everything when things start to get really rough and I get depressed, because I'm always only human. You know, there'll be times of great pain and things like that. I usually don't allow myself to wallow in that state of despair for too long, because really there's no benefit in doing that. And I mostly have to consciously divert my focus onto Jesus, and that helps me cope knowing that I'm not alone.
Well, as I'm listening to you right now, and of course I have the privilege of knowing you personally, but Elizabeth, I'm just really kind of amazed. I'm just guessing your children have picked up on your attitude too, and maybe you've built some resilience in them.
Well, funny you should mention that. I know we'll probably be talking later about my second diagnosis, but it came about 6 years later, and at that time, I kind of had an eye-opener as to how I was raising my children. You know, my children go to church and we pray and things like that. But I sort of had my eyes open to the fact that I wasn't sure if I was raising them with enough of a firm foundation in Christ that I could be guaranteed that they wouldn't turn their back toward God and blame God if something happened to me. And that kind of shook me up and forced me to really parent with a purpose. So I have to say, at the first time around when my children were just 2 and 4 months old, at that point I was just trying to cope with the diagnosis and my treatments. I wasn't too involved as a parent during that time. I needed help from my own mom because my children were quite demanding then. And as they got older, life sort of happens and you parent. I realized that I had so many responsibilities as a parent, and it's so demanding that it's easy to get caught up in the day-to-day parenting and disciplining and raising them without really being focused on their spiritual growth to that degree. So I must say definitely now I can praise God for my diagnosis because of one of the reasons is I parent with a purpose so much more now. And everything colors how I parent. This cancer, we use it as an example. If my children are having a bad day or being bullied or this or that, how life is unfair, and you can expect your circumstances to not always be the way you want them to be, but you can still have joy on the inside regardless of what happens. And that's been kind of an underlying foundation that I'm trying to raise my children with so that they realize that we don't have to rely on the situation and the circumstances, the rainy days, if you will, to color how our attitude is going to be and how we respond.
Well, you know, what I think is powerful about that is a couple of weeks ago in the studio, we had Maggie Clausen and Marty Hansen here. Marty and Maggie work with a group at the Antioch Group in the evenings, and they teach them life skills using a modality called dialectical behavioral therapy, DBT, okay? Well, basically, for our audience, again, as a review, if they listen to that program, DBD talks about having mindfulness, distress tolerance, appropriate or reasonable expectations, and it talks about validation. And it talks about the ability to be real in the moment with your feelings, but being controlled or measured. Now, as I think about all of that, long before the people who take credit for developing that modality, and apparently it started in the East, made its way to the Western world, the Bible was talking about that a long time ago. In fact, Jesus really modeled what we know in today's world is dialectical behavioral therapy. And that is the ability to help us cope with the unfairness and the uncertainty of life in ways that help us to maintain our faith and extend empathy to others and not allow ourselves to get into self-pity or into a place where we just are thinking about us.
Yeah, it's interesting. I tend to be very simplistic in my spiritual teaching. And so I don't know, I definitely am clueless about all of the counseling terminology. But one of the things that I love and I've taught my children and I apply it to myself too is the importance, and I call it stepping inside of the cross. And to me, I kind of picture myself standing up straight inside the cross and the wooden pieces are all around me, my front, my back, my side. I can look straight up and see God and His light shining on me. You can see the cross beams of the cross, and I'm completely protected. I'm completely sheltered. I'm safe inside of the cross, inside of Jesus' arms. And when I'm outside of the cross, when I'm living outside, then all sorts of things can penetrate. They can, I'm being attacked. There's arrows. There's bats swinging at me. There's words. There's gossip. There's bullies. There's cancer. There's relationship issues, financial issues, everything that can really knock us down, and it's hard to cope. And as a woman, especially, we tend to be driven by our emotions and our feelings, and so it's easy to kind of become consumed in the world, mm-hmm. what's going on around us. But once I make that conscious choice to step inside the cross, I'm protected. Suddenly, those things are coming at me, but they no longer penetrate deep within, and I'm able to kind of take a breath and step outside and realize that my identity is in Christ. It's not found in what people say to me or about me or how I'm defined by my circumstances. And I'm allowed to look upon others with Christ's empathy and compassion and all of the fruits of the Spirit that He has given me. But like I said, I'm unequipped on my own to when I'm outside of that protection. Mm-hmm. And so ideally, as Christians, we need to basically live inside of the cross rather than just back and forth and back and forth. But as you know, and as you grow and mature, then we must make that conscious choice to really allow God and the Holy Spirit to teach us and show us how to act and react.
Well, Elizabeth, what you just did is explain the spiritual underpinning in my mind for what DBT does.
Oh, good, because I did not understand that.
Well, my point is that it can be that simple. We make it complex. And as I listen to your explanation, there we are. You're being real. You're experiencing a lot of emotion. But ultimately, you come back to the place where you're centered and where you're most focused and where your strength comes from.
Right. And I've often said that to me, my ministry here is not about cancer. It's not about people who are suffering physically. This world is hard. There are so many things that people deal with on a day-to-day basis, much worse than what I'm going through. And I often tell people that in my opinion, I sometimes think relationship issues are harder to deal with than a physical issue because mm-hmm. for me, cancer is for the most part beyond my control. You know, I have doctors that advise me of what treatments to take and things like that. But, you know, there comes a point where I just have to accept the situation. Whereas I know in my own personal life, too, the relationships I've been in can be extremely consuming. You know, what should I say, not say? Am I enabling something? You know, it can be very, very difficult. And so I just feel like that the truths that I'm learning can be applied all around, not just with someone that has a physical issue.
Well, that speaks to a large part of our audience, and I really do appreciate you articulating that. That was very well done, Elizabeth. We're going to take a short break, and when we come back, we want to talk about two things. The second diagnosis that Elizabeth received, and then the venue that God has given her to speak not only to cancer, but truly to give inspiration to others. We'll be right back after the break.
Sometimes in life, many of us face problems we just can't work out all alone.
If you or someone you love struggles, turn to the caring counselors of the Antioch Group.
The Antioch Group offers counseling anchored in Christ, the true healer.
You can contact the Antioch Group at 692-6622, that's 692-6622, or on the web at antiochgroup.com.
The Antioch Group, beside you throughout life's journey.
Well, welcome back to Healing, Hope, and Restoration. We're visiting today in the studio with Elizabeth Grant. And Elizabeth, before the break, I mentioned that you had received a second diagnosis. And I know that you have truly walked through the valley of the shadow of death with this one. And this has really been a challenge for you. Would you just share with our audience how that affected you and, again, where you went to find strength?
Yes, well, it's pretty much every person's worst nightmare when they hear that they have cancer to fathom and think about it spreading and coming back. But like I said, whenever I was 28 and initially received the diagnosis, I grew so much closer in my faith during that time that I remember consciously telling myself, you know, if I ever had cancer again, if it ever came back, I just know it's not going to break me. And that's how much I just really saw Jesus become so alive into my life. And so fast forward 6 years and the cancer did come back. It wasn't really as much of a shock to me. I guess I always, in the back of my head, thought that that was a possibility that could happen. But what was a shock was I wasn't sure where that cancer was located. Whenever I was going through tests, then all that I knew was that I had a large tumor at the base of my skull. And to me, I thought that that meant I had cancer in my brain and that it was going to progress and I would only have a few months left to live. And so that was a very traumatic time in my thinking in my life, because like I said a little bit earlier, it was that at that moment I realized I wasn't afraid of dying as much as I was afraid that my kids would blame God for it. And I wasn't sure, guaranteed, that I had given them enough of a foundation to be able to cling to God during the hard time instead of blaming him. So with that regards, I was pleased that I had more time to be able to raise them in that way. So it turned out that the cancer was not in my brain. It was in my bones. And I had never thought about the skull being a bone, but yes, it is. So the cancer is very, very widespread throughout most of my bones. It would take too long to actually list all the bones that I have cancer in. And it stayed in my bones for a couple of years. And then about a year ago, we discovered that it had spread to my brain. And so as of right now, I have two tumors in my brain, one that has been treated and one that has not been treated, but is currently not growing. And I also have quite a few tumors in my liver. So I've been on constant treatments for over 3 years, whether that be chemotherapy, hormone therapy, or radiation. And needless to say, that has done a number on me physically as well as mentally. I've recognized just how interrelated pain and your mental stability go hand in hand. So in those times when it really is difficult, then I just try to get an eternal perspective on things. And it kind of puts me in my place and helps me to realize what is important in life. Sometimes I think about Jesus dying on the cross and how much he suffered physically, and my suffering is nowhere near the pain that he had to suffer. So that kind of helps me cope. And I also realize that God is the ultimate parent. As much as I would love to be around for my children, I've had to let go of that and recognize that God is sovereign, and he has my children. He will continue to draw them, and they will continue to seek him. And I know that ultimately, if I need to not be around, then God has a plan and will make good from that. And so I don't always pray for my will and what I want, because I would so much rather him be in control of my life. Yeah. What I think is best may not be what's best. So I had to remind myself of that.
Well, that's powerful. That is just very moving. In fact, as you were talking, I was reminded of a study in the 1990s that Duke University did. I think they polled 290 family physicians, and they found that people with serious or terminal illnesses did far better. 93% of the doctors believe that prayer and faith and strong social or family connections were the two things that kept people going and made a difference, whether they passed from that disease or whether they fought it and moved on with their life. They found that across the board, faith and social support were vital. I'm sure you've experienced
definitely
that.
Definitely. And I feel like it's not just the mind is a powerful thing, and it's not just a mind trick that we give ourselves, but the Holy Spirit really does work, and Jesus really does transform you from the inside out and just makes you a new person. And that's, to me, the beauty of it. That's why I can't sit here and complain and griping that, you know, oh, poor me. I feel blessed. I feel like the things that I've learned, you know, I'm constantly being shaped more like Christ, and What? How could something be so bad if it draws you closer to God? To me, it's a good thing. One of the things that really has gotten me through is a particular scripture that I found about 9 years ago with my first diagnosis, and I love it, and I think about it, and I feel like this, if anything, is my life scripture, and it's found in 2 Corinthians 4:16-18. It says, "Therefore, we do not lose heart, though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day." And to me, that's so important. "For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all." And it may not seem like our troubles are light and momentary, but the reality of it is that they are, especially when faced in light of eternity. And the scripture continues to say, "So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." And to me, that's how I try to live my life. You know, if I can easily get consumed by what is seen, by the circumstances around me, by my physical pain, but I try to fix my eyes on what is unseen, which is Jesus. And that's what's truth. That's what's constant. That's what I can count on. I can't count on anything in this world. It's so chaotic, but I can count on Jesus.
Well, you know, and the Lord has truly used this as an opportunity for you to speak in His behalf. I think of the TV interview that you did locally, another radio interview that you did. A couple months ago, the Journal Star did an article. It had a wonderful picture of you on the front. I know my wife made sure she saved that. And so you've had those venues, but I'm recalling something that I thought was very moving. A year ago, a little over a year ago, at a local hotel on behalf of the Halt Center, you were one of the speakers. And I think of all the movers and shakers in Peoria who were there, as well as a lot of other people who have been tied or connected to cancer in some way. We're in this huge room, and you gave your testimony, and I was just absolutely moved when the place erupted into standing applause. That was powerful, Elizabeth.
Thank you.
That was very powerful. And then you have a blog, and you know, God's really opened some doors for you to really speak in His name through this.
It's really, I definitely give God the glory, because I am just a nobody. I'm just an introverted little person who is very self-absorbed at times. But what happened with my second diagnosis is I do like to write. I like to journal, and it's very therapeutic for me. So I started a blog to mostly keep my family updated on the medical issues and things that were going on, because we don't have family here locally. And I just kind of spew everything, all of my thoughts. Some of them are about my children and the struggles there, but often whatever God wants me to speak, I speak about spiritual things too as well, things I'm learning, and I just try to be vulnerable. And if people want to read it, great. And I think God has really done a lot through it, touched people that I don't even know. So whatever He wants to do with it is fine with me.
Well, recently I just referred one of my clients to your blog, because they're facing with their family a similar situation, and I just thought they would maybe receive some encouragement from it. And I think what's funny is that my wife will read your blog, and because she knows you so well, she reads between the lines. So she'll be reading to me, and she'll either laugh or she'll cry, because she can tell.
That's funny.
They can tell the emotion that you know, that you have behind what you're saying.
Well, my blog is called deadmanskipping.com, and I chose that title because everybody is going to die. We're all on this journey of life. We don't know when that's going to happen, but I personally want to be someone that's skipping along on my way toward eternity, rather than just crawling and drudging along. And so I'm hoping that my blog can help people, no matter what they're going through, kind of find the joy in the midst of the trial.
Well, again, I just admire that courage. I don't know how I would feel if I were in that place. I know when we pray for you, Elizabeth, my prayer is, God, no one tells you what to do. You do what you do, that our days are numbered. But if we had our way, God, touch Elizabeth.
And, thank you.
And I think of your children.
Thank you.
You know, they're just so precious. when you have these media opportunities or these venues where you spoke at the hotel, what goes through your mind when you think, hey, I've been asked to do this?
Well, first of all, I get very, very nervous because I am introverted and not a speaker. But I also am very, very honored to be able to represent Jesus in this way. And I feel like he has created every single person so uniquely and uniquely gifted to do the ministry he has desired for you. And I have to smile because as introverted as I am, I also have a theater minor and I love to act. And so I sort of just go into that acting mode. I become who I need to be in that moment in order to speak. And then I go and crash and sleep it off. But, you know, a lot of people, my sisters included, say I could never get up and speak. And so I just smile at that. And I think, well, God designed me that way. I hate to say it, but I sort of thrive on the attention, which sounds so selfish, but God made me that way. And it's good to use it for him rather than in selfish reasons.
Well, for my money, I think you ought to publish. You're a good writer.
Thank you. All right. Any editors out there, if you want to, I'm open.
Well, Elizabeth, it's been such a pleasure to have you today. And folks, if you're listening today and something that Elizabeth has said has touched you, I'm going to have her give her blog site again. But if you have any questions for me, since I know Elizabeth and you want to ask me anything about the program today, give us a call at the Antioch Group at 309-692-6622. Or you can visit us on the web at antiochgroup.com. And those are two ways that you can get a hold of us. And you can, you know, ask any question or find out any information about the group. But if today's program has been of particular interest to you, you can certainly visit Elizabeth's blog, or you can call the Antioch Group and ask for me, and we'll be happy to answer any questions you might have. Elizabeth, why don't you just give them your blog site again, because I think that would be a great way for people to join you.
Great. Thank you so much. It's www.deadmanskipping.com.
Well, again, Elizabeth, the Lord bless you and keep you in his strength and in his care, and thank you so much for coming on today.
Thank you so much.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, that's all for today. We'll see you next week on Healing, Hope, and Restoration. Until then, God bless and shalom.
This is Dr. Stephen Hammond. A wise man once said, "Life is complex." At the Antioch Group, we help with life's difficulties, offering confidential Christian counseling for children, teens, adults, and couples. Call us at 692-6622 or visit us on the web at antiochgroup.com. The Antioch Group, beside you throughout life's journey.